First of all, thank you for giving me this opportunity to have a talk here, which is based on a work with David, Enrico, and Filippo. We will talk about a weakly broken Galilean symmetry. We will define what I mean with this, and we will apply a theory with the weakly broken Galilean symmetry to inflation as an example. So, this is the overview of the presentation. We will briefly recall what Galilean transformations are. We will define what a theory with weakly broken Galilean symmetry is. We will couple our theory to gravity, and we will discuss the physical consequences. In particular, we will apply our framework to inflation, and at the end, we will draw the conclusions. So, what's the general idea? Usually, as everybody knows, in the context of inflation, the shift symmetry plays a key role, but we won't go further and consider a different symmetry. So these kind of symmetry transformations that are called the Galilean transformation, which have to be approximate because, for example, gravity is going to break the Galilean symmetry explicitly. But the aim of the presentation is to study theories which retain as much as possible the Galilean symmetry. And this will naturally lead to the concept of a weakly broken Galilean invariance, where by weak I mean that we want to retain as much as possible the symmetry, in a sense that we will define later. So this is the general idea. Maybe I could skip this slide because of what we have just learned before, but let me change the point of view. Maybe it's useful. Let's start with this kind of scalar theory. We have the kinetic term plus three interactions. Without going through the details of the derivative combinations they involve, let's concentrate on the properties. This theory is exact invariant under Galilean transformations. The coefficients Ci here, so C3, C4, and C5, are not renormalized, so we do not have loop corrections, loop contributions to these kind of coefficients. And as a result, we have second-order equations of motion, and as we have learned during the first lesson of this morning, this is a good point. So, let's consider the cubic Galilean term. So, let's consider this simple example. This slide, I think, contains all the ingredients we need later, so maybe it's the most important one. And so let's go through the details. As I told you, this Lagrangian is invariant under Galilean transformations. We know that this invariance has to be broken. So let's break it, but weakly. Let's introduce a small breaking. By small, I mean let's introduce, for example, a quartic term which is suppressed by a scale lambda 2 bigger than lambda 3. So now the symmetry is broken, so we expect that symmetry breaking operators of this form are generated by quantum corrections. The question is, at which scale do these quantum corrections enter? So maybe one may naively expect that we can have this kind of loop contribution, so we can build a loop diagram with one insertion of the quartic vertex and two insertions of the cubic one. But so this means this diagram is contributing at a scale lambda 2. But this is not the answer, because this diagram, one can prove that, is not there at all. Instead, so the other possibility is to consider loop diagram with two insertions of the quartic vertex. coming from the small breaking term. So this diagram is its contribution is this form, defined to the fourth. We have the scale here, but it is suppressed by a small factor, 4. So I mean that we have the symmetry breaking operators are generated not at the scale lambda 2, but at a scale which is parametrically higher than lambda 2. Namely, the operator d phi to the fourth gets only small corrections under through loop effects. So, as I told you, we have to introduce gravity. And so we want to generalize this simple theory. We want to couple our theory to gravity following this guide principle. We want to preserve the beautiful quantum properties I've told you before. So the fact that at the end we have small quantum corrections. And we will find a class of theory with weakly broken Galilean symmetry invariants. And as a consequence, they will have second-order equations of motion. So when we apply our framework to inflation, this will provide a radiatively stable cosmological evolutions. So obviously, we can have many possibilities. We can couple our theories to gravity in many ways. This breaks the Galilean invariants. And as we did before, let's concentrate on this kind of loop quantum-generated operators. And we can see that the coupling to gravity defines the sense in which the symmetry breaking can be considered weak, in the sense that among all the possibilities we can consider, we want to choose a particular coupling to gravity for which the symmetry is weakly broken, in this sense. So, for example, the answer is this one. Let's consider the previous Galilean theory. You recognize the free Lagrangian terms, but with these two non-minimal coupling. So one can prove that the quantum generated operators d phi to the 2n enter at a particular scale, which is not arbitrary, but at a scale which is, as you can see, En, Planck mass, for n minus 4. In other words, this scale is always bigger than n Planck lambda 3, 3, 1, 4. So it's asymptotically equal, but not for it's in general it's bigger. And the crucial point is that the ratio between the number of d phi squared legs and the number of gravitons of M Planck is always less than 1 or equal to 1. In other words, we have 2n at the numerator and 1n at the denominator. This is a crucial point. In general, one could expect, for example, d phi 2n mass Planck to the k power lambda 3 for n minus k minus 4, something like this. But this is not the case. So in other words, The loop corrections are suppressed by a big scale. If we had chosen a different coupling to gravity, we would have obtained quantum corrections suppressed by a smaller scale. So this is the point. So this kind of non-minimal coupling is defining the sense in which the symmetry breaking is considered weak. We can generalize more the previous theory, we can simply multiply each Lagrangian term by an arbitrary polynomial g of x, where x is the kinetic term. The g4x, g5x is simply the derivative with respect to the to x, but the result is the same. The coefficients of the polynomial gi are not renormalized up to some power of a small factor. So this is the sense in which the symmetry breaking is considered weak. So in order to have an idea of an application, let's consider this kind of action. Let's apply it to inflation. We have our theory, the previous one. We have the Einstein-Hilbert action. We have a potential, which is, for example, something like this. The lambda and the mass can be arbitrarily small because these are the only two terms that are breaking the shift symmetries, which otherwise is exact in this theory without V. So we can do the standard analysis. We can compute the equations of motion for the field, the Friedman-Robinson walk, etc. But at the end, for example, we can have that if the potential is zero, we have an exact linear solution. Otherwise, we have slight deviations from the sitter. But at the end, the main point is that in both cases, because of what I've told you before, the quantum corrections are fully under control. So this is an important point for the consistency of the theory. So we can change the point of view and consider an effective theory approach, as we have learned during this school. The effective field theory approach is based on the simple idea that, in general, in nature, when the physics at small scales does not qualitatively affect the large scales behavior. And so we can, for example, concentrate on the degrees of freedom that appear at low energy in order to infer model-independent consequences. And this also, interestingly, applies to inflation. Here we have the inventors of the original application. And using the standard IDM variable, we can fix the gauge. We can make the fluctuations disappear from the scalar field, and they will be eaten by the metric. So we can write down the most general action in ADM variables with for the perturbations, which is invariant under the residual symmetry. And this is the result. It's not important to go through the details. Let me just stress the fact that, for example, the second line, the third one, we have the cubic terms. With the effective mass coefficients, as you can see. So we expect that the previous theory, once we choose the unitary gauge, each term of the previous theory will contribute in some way to each of these mass term. And it can also be interesting to see if there are hierarchies between these coefficients, because these could influence the phenomenology. And the most convenient way is to use the symmetries, as we do in the standard model of particle physics, when we say that, for example, the chiral symmetry is at the basis of the fact that at the basis of the technical naturalness of mass of the fermion masses. So these are the contributions. So every Lagrangian term of our theory is contributing in some way. It doesn't matter the particular form of the contributions, but it's contributing to these effective coefficients. The two main points are that we have a relatively stable hierarchy between these coefficients, which is stable under quantum corrections, and we can also see that the operators dk squared, dkij squared, r3dn appear only through these kind of combinations, and for the same reason it's stable under quantum corrections. We can go farther, and for example study two different regimes depending on the values of the parameters of the theory. For example, a kinetically driven phase in which the mixing with gravity is order one important at all scales, so we cannot choose a particular energy regime in which the mixing with gravity can be safely neglected. And in other words, the decoupling limit does not apply. And a potentially driven phase in which the decoupling limit applies, we can have some phenomenology with possible large non-Gaussianities, etc. But this is still work in progress. So let me summarize. We have seen the consequences of an approximate Galilean symmetry. Among all the possible couplings to gravity, we have chosen the more invariant, in the sense we have seen, and this has provided the notion of weakly broken Galilean invariance. And as a consequence, the resulting action belongs to a subclass of Ordensky theories with second-order equations of motion, and this is, as we have learned this morning, a good point. The resulting effective theory has two scales, lambda 3 and lambda 2, as I briefly mentioned. And this is generalizing, in a sense, the non-renormalization properties of Galileans. For the physical application, an important point is that the Sitter solutions we want to build with this framework are automatically insensitive to loop corrections. And we can also, we didn't have time, but we can also apply this framework to, in the context of late time cosmic acceleration, dark energy, but okay, this is another possible study, but okay. I think we can stop here. That's all. Okay, thank you.